So first slide I have to show always is a disclaimer to see where I'm really getting my money from. So I am a speaker for Reckitt Benckiser, which is the company that makes Suboxone. I'm not talking about treatment. Dr. Brunner will be talking about treatment. I also work in a methadone clinic down at the psychiatry department at Wayne State, and I work at the currently work at the detox center for Don Farm. So I like to describe myself as being broad-minded. I've also been accused of being promiscuous. I'll let you decide which one's more accurate tonight. So, and I always want to show this picture. This is Dr. Pat Gibbons, who we lost in March. He was the previous medical director at Don Farm, and probably everybody who was involved in addiction and psychiatric care in Washtenaw County and Detroit knew him well, and we won't recover easily from losing this great doctor. So the first thing is, and this sounds like a ridiculous question, everybody here has to decide for themselves, what is addiction? And I can guarantee you there is probably as many opinions as there are people here in the audience. So the most common one is that it's just physiologic dependence, which pretty much just means withdrawal when you come off medications. Or you can say that you're a weak-willed person, or you can say that you're a bad person, and as you know, about two-thirds of the inmates in Michigan have a history of drug or alcohol use or abuse. Or it's an actual mental illness, a brain disease. And the first idea, tolerance and withdrawal, is the most popular one. And tolerance means that you have to take more and more of the drug to get the same effect. So if you use Xanax or alcohol to relax yourself, you'll find yourself going from one beer to two beers to a six-pack. And finally, a lot of people are using a case of beer a night to try and just calm themselves down. When you stop that drug, you get the opposite effect. So when you stop drinking or using Xanax, you get anxious, jittery, tremulous, and you might even be at risk from a seizure. Now, this is a sweeping statement, but neither one of these have anything to do with addiction. Let me explain why that's true. I can take everybody here in the audience and force feed you morphine, assuming you've had a major car accident. And after about 2 weeks, when your insurance runs out, we're going to have to stop your morphine suddenly. Everybody here in the audience will become sick, okay? And about 85 to 95% of you will get over that physical withdrawal and go on with your lives. And about 10 to 15% of us, 5% is the low number, will go out and rob the party store across the street to get more, because that morphine has activated the disease of addiction in us. And I'm going to show you how that happens. And drug withdrawal, this slide isn't that clear, but drug withdrawal, which occurs with everybody who stops using a pain med after 2 weeks, is controlled by an area called the locus coeruleus, that's the LC in the back of the slide, which is in the back of your brain. And everybody has that. Patients who are trying to be treated for addiction assume that that's their problem. But their problem that we're going to talk about is higher up in the primitive forebrain. It's an area called the nucleus accumbens, which is your pleasure center. We're going to talk about how that is damaged in addiction, and Dr. Brunner is going to talk about how to treat it. How about willpower? Now, these are four gentlemen who were alleged to have problems with drugs and alcohol. The two on the left were alleged to be amphetamine addicts. The two on the right were alleged to be alcoholics. I've tried to mix up Republicans and Democrats equally here. Now, you can say what you want about any four of these gentlemen, but no one has accused any of these four of having a lack of willpower. And history is full of strong-willed alcoholics and addicts, and you probably know yourself some very strong-willed alcoholics and addicts. There simply is no relationship between willpower and whether or not you are controlled by addiction. How about morals? Now, everybody knows the guy on the right because of the cigar. That's Freud. Freud was a cocaine addict. He thought that cocaine was a treatment for alcoholism, and he found out the hard way that it wasn't. And he died because he, not because of the cocaine, but he died from oral cancer, and he tried to treat his own oral cancer with cocaine and operate on himself, which probably shows there's something wrong with his brain as well. Okay. Now, the guy on the left, I'm a former cancer surgeon. This is God. Okay. This is William Halstead. He is the father of cancer surgery in the U.S., and considered to be one of the greatest surgical teachers of all time, and that's what I used to do for a living. He was a hopeless cocaine addict. He not only was addicted himself, he got his fellows, his colleagues, his residents addicted. You can only imagine what rounds were like with him in the morning. And no one has accused either one of these gentlemen of being immoral, And many, many people traveled to see this guy and try and cure both of them, and neither one of them were cured. If you go on YouTube and you put either one of these names in, there's a video about both these doctors together and how cocaine took both of them down. So we're left with talking about a brain disease, a mental illness, and that's what I'm going to try and focus on tonight. And the culprit here is, in this picture here, is the red dot, the primitive forebrain called the nucleus accumbens. Nucleus means a collection of cells. And this is what controls your pleasure and drives you to stay alive. So it makes you want to do things that keep the race going. So for example, you crave sex, you have sex, you enjoy sex. That's all mediated by your nucleus accumbens. And that has a purpose, so the race stays alive. Now in addiction, the nucleus accumbens gets hijacked and actually starts enjoying rewards that give a higher amount of pleasure, which is mediated by the pleasure drug, which is dopamine. So for example, an addict will become addicted to internet pornography. And there are several statements you can make about internet pornography, but one of them is that the chance of you procreating is actually quite low. Okay? So that doesn't normally happen. So the function of that is so the race goes on, but it's been hijacked, it's been bypassed when you talk about addiction. Right behind it is what we're going to show you is the gas tank for the nucleus accumbens, the VTA, which is the ventral tegmental area, and that's where dopamine gets sent to the nucleus accumbens to make you want to do something, and then it rewards you for doing it. So it's a continuous cycle of desire and reward. This is Daryl Strawberry. He was a bad, bad cocaine addict, and he lost his career. He went to prison, and this is a statement he made in front of the judge. Probably someone told him to say it. But he told the judge, my brain is broken. And he was right. He was completely addicted to cocaine. And I knew that he went to prison. I knew he had stage 4 colon cancer. And I always kind of assumed that he died. And I was getting ready for this talk. I just decided to Google the name. And lo and behold, he runs a treatment center. He's been clean for like 15 years. Okay, and he recognized eventually, I doubt it was true when he talked to the judge, but he recognized that he had a severe mental illness and that he needed treatment. And it wasn't due to withdrawal, it was due to addiction. So again, we're talking about the nucleus accumbens, which is the pleasure center, and it responds to dopamine from the gas tank, which is the ventral tegmental area. And if you look at this slide, all the drugs of abuse that we talk about, either directly or indirectly, feed on the nucleus accumbens and cause dopamine release. So you enjoy using a drug, and then you turn around and you crave using the drug. And if you have addiction, you can't stop doing it. We'll show how that happens also. More bad news. Those of you who stop at the bar on the way home tonight and just have a couple beers and then stop because you don't want to get a drunk driving ticket, that's your prefrontal cortex inhibiting your nucleus accumbens. And that's how it's supposed to work. That puts the wheels on your pleasure center so that you don't wind up spending the night in jail. That's how normal people think. The prefrontal cortex, which actually is what you are, is also broken in people who have the disease of addiction. I'll show you some evidence for that also. So not only is the nucleus accumbens out of control and the gas tank is full, but the brake line has been cut and you have no inhibition for your pleasure center. This is a study by Nora Volkoff, who is the medical director of the National Institute of Drug Abuse. And what you're looking at in these slides is you're looking down at someone's brain. Remember, your brain is symmetric, so you have a pleasure center on both sides of your brain. And on the left, you're looking at three normal, healthy people. And you're looking at the dopamine inside their pleasure centers. That's the red area. So the red that you see is a normal amount of dopamine giving you a normal amount of pleasure. Now look at the right. We have a cocaine addict, an alcoholic, and a heroin addict. And you can see that in each slide there's much less dopamine. And this is one theory of addiction called the reward deficiency syndrome that says that addicts have less dopamine, they have less pleasure, they feel terrible, so they spend all their lives trying to catch up by using behaviors and drugs that give them more pleasure than normal life does. Heroin gives you more pleasure than a candy bar. Now, people don't really dispute that. Okay. Now, there's one problem with this theory, and it's been raised. that you can say, well, all you're looking at is brain damage. If you use drugs, you burn out your brain. So the three people on the right are brain damaged from using drugs. Okay, let's see if there's any additional evidence. This is a study done in California where they took people, and it was volunteers. These are people who were not using drugs yet. They had negative drug screens. There's like 20 of them. I don't know how they found 20 in California. But they took these people, they did brain scans, and then they injected them with IV Ritalin, methylphenidate. That would be similar to you injecting yourself with methamphetamine. And they asked them, did you enjoy that? Now, most of the audience, not all the audience, I can tell you, would find that to be a terrible experience. You'd be shaky, you know, your heart would race, you'd get chest pain. A lot of us would think that was heaven, okay? Most of us not. So here's someone who said, this was terrible. Look at their brain. There's a normal amount of dopamine. Here's someone who said, can I have more? Look at their dopamine. These people have not started using drugs. They had negative drug screens. People who are born with less dopamine enjoy drugs more than people who are born with normal dopamine. So that's where the genetics come in. And genetics probably accounts for half of addiction. And the genetics part may be your dopamine activity or amount or receptors or whatever is defective. And this is the rest of the study. Here are the folks who enjoyed it. Look at the lower levels. Here are the folks who didn't enjoy it. Look at the higher levels. So the conclusion is that addiction is an abnormal response to a drug or reward. In this case, the reward is IV Ritalin, and most of you would not consider that to be a reward at all. Anybody here remember this ad? I had to search for this ad for a long time. I remember my parents having this newspaper in their house. Are you smoking more and enjoying it less? Okay, that is, by itself is the definition of addiction. Using more and enjoying it less. And that is because you become tolerant, you go into withdrawal, and your dopamine levels go down when you continue to use a drug. Now their solution here is to switch to Camels, which by the way give you more nicotine, so it's like building up to a higher quality grade of heroin. Pretty much the same thing. More bad news. Women who are overweight were given brain scans and compared to normal controls. It turns out that they had less dopamine in their brain and the dopamine didn't work as well. Also, when they gave these women milkshakes and did brain scans, it turned out they enjoyed the milkshake less. Not more, less. We always think somebody who overeats or overdrinks or whatever is enjoying it more than the normal person. It turns out they may be enjoying it less, but they're doing more to catch up. So they have a decreased response to a reward, so they have to overuse in order to compensate. Now, I urge everybody who has any interest or any exposure or any family member who has addiction to come to an open 12-step talk. There is an excellent 12-step talk here on Saturday night at 7:30. Open step means the public is welcome. You don't have to be an alcoholic or an addict. If you come and hear somebody share their story, you will always hear this phrase in some version. I didn't belong in my own skin. I felt less than. I felt different. And what they're describing is what we call hedonic tone, that normal level of pleasure that a normal person has that the alcoholic or addict does not. I always show this slide. I want you to pick the future addict in the room, okay? And people will normally pick the three on the bottom. I think these are the St. Joe's executives or administrators down here. Those are normal folks, okay? But look at the top of the slide. Look at the girl up there. Look how intensely unhappy she looks. Now this is obviously contrived, but the idea here is if you are born with decreased hedonic tone, she is going to learn sooner or later that she can use a drug or a behavior and she can feel like her buddies in the front for a while until she develops tolerance and withdrawal, and then she's going to use more and more and get less and less from it. And that really is what addiction turns into. Next thing is, why cannot addicts and alcoholics stop for good? Most people who have alcoholism or addiction have stopped at least once. Some have stopped because they've been hospitalized or incarcerated, and the relapse rate coming out of the hospital or the jail is 95 to 99%. Okay? Why does this happen? Let's show you some information. This is a picture of brain metabolism. This is glucose metabolism showing how hard your brain is working. The one on the left is a normal control brain, red and happy, which means the brain is functioning. The one on the right is an active cocaine addict, and their brain, it looks like they pulled the plug on the machine, okay? And anybody who has a friend or relative who's a cocaine addict knows there isn't a whole lot of judgment and higher executive functioning going on when you're using cocaine. But here's more bad news. This study was done, the same study, the slides look a little bit different. And what they did was they took controls, and then they took people who had stopped using cocaine. So on the top, you have three control patients, and the red and yellow is how you're supposed to look. That's your normal level of metabolism. Then they took three patients who had stopped using cocaine 10 days ago. Now you can tell there's really nothing going on in that brain. It's all blue. Blue means nothing. Nothing happening. And you would say, well, okay, but it's only been 10 days. I got news for you. That's when you get out of most treatment centers nowadays, because your insurance won't pay for anything more. Okay? More bad news. The three on the bottom just got their 90-day chip, and look at their brains. There still is dramatic evidence of brain damage at 100 days out. By the way, if you were an impaired doctor, this is when we would let you go back to doing surgery. Is anybody here having surgery next week? Think about it, okay? And it turns out it takes about a year and a half to recover your brain function when you stop using drugs and alcohol. So when someone gets out of treatment, gets out of Brighton Hospital after 2 weeks and drives to the bar straight from Brighton Hospital, we say, why on earth did he do that? Why would someone do that? They did it because they're brain damaged. If you had a relative who had a massive stroke, would you send them home from the hospital and say, I want you to drive home, pick up some groceries on the way home, and then go home and clean the house? No, you put them in rehab. We don't do that with addiction patients. We give them a week, and then we turn them loose. Okay, so how do you tell if you're addicted? If you go by the old criteria, which is the DSM-4, now the DSM-5 rolls this all into one. Here's the criteria for addiction. Tolerance, withdrawal, you take more than you planned on, you can't cut down, you spend all your time doing it, you give up everything for it, you use this by the physical or a psychiatric problem. If you have three of those in the past 12 months, then your doctor says you have addiction to whatever it is you're addicted to. But there's a better definition, and that is to describe the craving and compulsion that the addict has. Use the four C's. Those of you who have a relative or even yourself who has addiction, you're going to recognize this. All you do is crave it, which means when you don't have it, it's all you're thinking about. You have to use it to feel normal. And I'm not talking about a hangover. I'm talking about if I don't have my three martinis when I come home, I'm a raging monster. I'm a dry drunk, as they call it. I lose control, meaning I might stop at three martinis or I might drink 12, and then I'm going to wind up in jail that night. And I use despite consequences. That's the four C's. And I like to throw in a fifth C, which is it's chronic. We don't diagnose alcoholism based on one drunk driving conviction. In fact, most people who have a DWI are not alcoholics. But it's a chronic, repeating pattern where at the time when you must not use, you cannot not use. That's a triple negative, but it's true. Now, if you look at these two people, no one would doubt that these two are addicts. So here's a gentleman injecting heroin. Here's somebody, you know, panhandling money outside a store or something. Need cash for alcohol research, okay? And it always upsets the audience, but if you smoke, you're an addict. You fulfill all five of the five C's and all seven of the DSM-4 and most of the DSM-5, which is a combination of abuse and addiction. But there's also behavioral dependence. So those of you who have gotten multiple emails from Jim Ballmer and wonder how he does it, here's a snapshot of his computer keyboard late at night. You can see the tobacco and the gin and everything else. Here's somebody spending too much time at the, you know, Motown casino, and here's somebody who has eating addiction, which we're also going to talk about. And these are as bad. They show as much brain changes, as much brain damage as do other drugs. So one drug I always want to mention is methamphetamine. Methamphetamine is a terrible drug because it destroys the neurons that make dopamine. So here is a control patient, and there's a methamphetamine addict, and you can see how much less dopamine there is in that person's brain. And we have another addict on the bottom who also has brain damage. And what is their addiction? Food. That's an obese subject, okay? Food causes the same brain changes that heroin does. And we have a separate talk on eating disorders that I think will be given next spring. Yeah. Now, the first time I heard this, I thought this was some kind of religious statement. You'll hear people say that they're cross-addicted. And what this means is that they have become abstinent from one addiction and flipped over to another, and they will sometimes flip back and forth or move on to another one. And we give this a fancy name. We call it addiction transfer, but it's cross-addiction. That's what it means. Typically, when you have an alcoholic who becomes abstinent, they gain weight, they start eating, they gamble, they get involved in pornography, they get involved in sex, they'll destroy their marriages. And it's very common, if they are not really involved in a recovery program, to go out and cause more damage than they did when they were drinking. People who have gastric bypass surgery, which is a way of kind of clamping down on eating addiction without treating it, will typically become addicted to alcohol, opiates, or sedatives. And I worked down at the Detroit Medical Center, and my most common consult is pregnancy, because I'm an OB-GYN. But my second most common consult is the bariatric service, trying to treat someone who had bariatric surgery, lost 150 pounds, and they can't get them off their Dilaudid. It's a very common occurrence. So we briefly mentioned abuse. What is abuse? Let me give you an example. So you have a friend who drinks too much. And she's been drinking for 20 years, and she just found out she has high blood pressure and her cholesterol is up, which we're going to mention in a few minutes. And you advise her to quit because you are now an expert in addiction. And you have been to the Don Farm lecture, and you know that she can't quit because she has addiction, but you're going to advise her to go to Brighton or something. And surprise, she quits. She never drinks again. And your response to this is, I'm never going to go to one of those damn talks again. They don't know what you're talking about. Okay? So what happened? What's going on? This is somebody who had alcohol abuse, which is simply a behavior, a risky behavior. And I'm sure all of you know, those of you who went to high school, college, professional school, you all know people who drank too much, used too much, and then when it came time to stop, they just stopped cold. And you also know people who could not stop. Okay? And that's what separates the abuser from the alcoholic. And abuse is the other half of the new DSM-5. You don't fulfill your work obligations. You use in risky situations. You drive drunk. You have recurrent legal problems. Now, a lot of addictionists, including myself, disagree with this. We feel if somebody has more than one DWI, it means they have driven drunk probably about 500 times. And I think that kind of escalates into something beyond simple abuse. You use despite social or personal problems, and MOR stands for marriage on the rocks or relationship on the rocks, and you are not an addict, okay? So this is somebody who has bad behavior that is causing them problems, but they can stop, and they typically do stop if you counsel them. And most people you are going to see do not have addiction. They have abuse. And most people who have an alcohol problem can stop. We're going to talk about how that's been extrapolated way beyond what it's supposed to mean in a second. And you can use the four C's either for yourself or for somebody else to see whether or not you think this is an abuse problem or an addiction problem. I ask people, you know, tell me how you think about your drinking and tell me the last time you tried to stop, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And this has led to a plethora of organizations and books who are pretty much based on hatred of AA. And you can usually identify them by reading them, and they say, we have the solution. AA is not the solution. By the way, send us a check. I've never seen one of these organizations offer to do it without some kind of remuneration. So let me give you a different take on this. So I'm an OBGYN, and I actually used to do GYN cancer surgery. These are two pictures of ovarian tumors. They're both women who are 45 years old, and these tumors are both about this big, okay? The one on the left has no family history. The one on the right has a family history of breast cancer. The one on the left has no genetic predisposition. She tests negative for all the cancer genes. The one on the right has the BRCA gene, BRCA, which gives you breast and ovarian cancer. Now, I don't know these patients. These are slides I took off the internet. But I can tell you with reasonable certainty, the one on the left did not die from that tumor, and the one on the right is dead from that tumor. Okay? Because the one on the right has the family history and the genetics, and that's what we call an epithelial ovarian cancer. And when I put these two slides up and I show these to OBGYN residents, and I take the information off the top, they usually can't tell me which one is which. And that's what addiction and abuse is. They act the same, but when you look at it, one has a family history, one has the genetics, and one can be a lethal disease. The other one is just you're acting like a schmuck, okay? Now, if I took this statement and I said, for every ovarian cancer, there is 100 benign tumors. Thus, ovarian cancer does not exist and we should stop worrying about it. You would do the right thing. You would call Lansing and have my medical license suspended because I'm an idiot, okay? But people do this all the time. They say, most people can quit drinking, therefore alcoholism does not exist. It does. Don't, when you hear that, don't worry about it. It is stupidity. That's really all you can call it. That's an opinion. And Mark Minestrina, who probably detoxed about 20,000 people at Brighton Hospital, he has a great statement I stole. Abuse is a behavior, addiction is a true disease. And that's what differentiates them. Now, let's talk about the next problem, relapse. Every patient I meet who wants treatment for their addiction will tell me initially, if I can just get through the withdrawal, if I can just get over the Vicodin, over the alcohol, over the Xanax, I'll be okay. They don't recognize there's more going on. And when I tell people that if they stop doing their treatment, their 12-step, their counseling, their medication, they're going to relapse, I am always told, don't worry, that will never happen to me. Everyone who relapses says, don't worry, that will never happen to me. So what's going on here? We know that there are three things that trigger relapse. One is the drug itself, or the behavior itself. The next is stress, and the third is cues, wet places and wet faces. And it turns out that we found out from animal studies what part of the brain that comes from. So these are slides are not dark enough, but the drug-triggered relapse. And I know people who celebrate their 30-day chip by going out to the bar and having a beer, okay? And I know patients that have done that and woken up in jail. That was triggered by the ventral tegmental area releasing dopamine to your nucleus accumbens, and you're off to the races. The stress-triggered relapse occurs in the part of the brain that releases what's called CRF that eventually makes cortisol in your body, and cortisol is a stress hormone, and alcoholics and addicts don't tolerate stress at all, and stress will often lead to relapse. And finally, the cues deal with two parts of the brain called the hippocampus and the amygdala that deal with emotional memory and the things that make you say whoa. And if you walk past a bar, you may find yourself walking into the bar, and that's because your amygdala and your hippocampus took over control and things are not going to go well. So just to reinforce what addiction is, as opposed to alcoholism or heroin addiction, what do you respond to? Okay, this is a great movie by Ray Milland, Lost Weekend, except for the last 10 minutes where his girlfriend cures him, which is kind of ridiculous, but otherwise it's a fantastic movie. This is a pile of cocaine, which will trigger massive amounts of dopamine release in cocaine-using subjects. And when they take the same cocaine-using subject and show them a shot of Bambi, there is no dopamine release. This is the holy, part of the holy trinity, which is Soma, Xanax, and Vicodin. You may have heard of it. Xanax and Vicodin are incredibly rewarding. In combination, they are beyond incredibly rewarding. And anybody who uses Xanax and Vicodin together probably has a drug abuse or addiction problem. Not probably. There's no legitimate reason to use these in combination unless you just had a car accident and you're going to take it for 3 days. Tobacco we already talked about. Here's somebody at the casino, and here's somebody at the computer. Okay? And here's my last slide, and this generates a lot of angst in a lot of people, so I'm going to take this off the screen here. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about consequences. Here's a gentleman who's going to wake up with a bad headache. And it says, rock bottom, you'll know it when you get there. Okay? So let's talk about some of the consequences of alcohol and drug use. One is hypertension. We have a fancy term in medicine called essential or idiopathic, which means we don't know what's causing it, but we're not going to admit it. Okay? And the most common cause of essential hypertension is alcohol. And the patient's drinking, you don't know it, they don't admit it, and every day when they come in, coming off alcohol, they have high blood pressure, and the blood pressure goes down that night when they drink. You get diabetes. It's very common for alcoholics to develop type 2 diabetes. Your bad cholesterol goes up. Your good cholesterol goes up too from the alcohol, but if you drink too much alcohol, that is a very, very small benefit. Your triglycerides, your fat goes up. You get a fatty liver. So you may go on a binge and you may wake up saying, God, my side hurts. And you push on your side and you go, whoa, okay? Your liver is expanding and being stretched because it's filling with fat because you're using alcohol for calories and you're storing your body fat. You may get hepatitis. This is nothing to laugh at. This is where you turn yellow, you get a fever, you start throwing up, and without treatment it can have like a 10 to 15% mortality. And finally, you can get a hepatitis. You can get alcoholic hepatitis, you can also get viral hepatitis. Almost all viral hepatitis conditions now are caused by hepatitis C rather than hepatitis B, which is the older one. And finally, you can get cirrhosis, which means the liver scars up, it can no longer regenerate, and that can be fatal. So let's say you have a friend who's an alcoholic, and things are not going well, and his family left him, and you go over to see him, and he denies having a problem, but says, I need to take a break. My wife's really giving me a hard time, and she needs to get away from me for a while. And he won't admit that he is the reason that everybody left. And you talk to him, and you're amazed at his ability to completely rationalize and how completely wrong he is. So these are all the psychological defenses we talk about in people who have an alcohol or drug problem. They criticize, they deflect, they deny, they rationalize, and they have absolutely no insight into their problem. And it's well known that recovering addicts make big, bad decisions. We have a colleague in our AA community who's a well-known and well-respected professor at a medical center very close to here, and he had a hard time stopping his alcohol use, and he would quit and start and quit and start. He actually quit for a few weeks, and he decided to celebrate by taking a trip to Amsterdam. When he came back, one side of his face was like half sanded off. He couldn't tell us why. His passport was gone. They revoked it at the airport. And he had a very, very bad recovery. There also is a joke we have in AA. If you had this in your family, you'll understand it. What does an alcoholic bring on a second date? And the answer is a U-Haul. Alcoholics are famous for jumping into relationships, often turning into bad relationships. And people will frequently hook up with somebody else and leave treatment saying, I've met the one, and you can bet that things are not going to go well. So here's a normal brain, a CAT scan, and there's an alcoholic 43-year-old, and that looks as bad as a 60-year-old normal brain, and I'm 61, so that looks bad, okay? It's all shrunk up, okay? And that is not recoverable. Once that happens, that's going to happen. So here is the combination of the comparison of different addictions and how they look the same in the brain. On the bottom, we have normal, happy people with a lot of red. We have a smoker, an alcoholic, a food addict, and a cocaine addict, and they all have the same problem. Their dopamine is gone. And I showed you that one study showing that that also started off that way. You didn't wind up that way. So you go back and see your friend. He's in the hospital. And you can tell that he really doesn't know who you are, but he's not going to admit it. So you start asking him some questions. And you say, you know, who's the president? Who's the president? And he says, well, who cares? They're all crooks. And, you know, what day is it? And you say, who cares? I'm retired. Okay? And when you watch him, he walks around like, kind of like this. Like he's not really sure if he can walk, and he keeps his hand on the wall. And what he is doing is he's showing you long-term signs of brain damage. And the part with the balance is your cerebellum is permanently damaged. And this is called Wernicke, starting off with Wernicke's encephalopathy, progressing to Korsakoff's psychosis, and this is what we used to call wet brain. This may not be recoverable. And this is typically seen back in the old days when we didn't have any treatment available, but we still see it nowadays. So you have confusion, agitation, and restlessness. And what you watch for, what you watch for is someone who makes things up to prevent you from realizing they don't know, so they can fabulate, and they have amnesia. And there's two kinds of amnesia. There's retrograde and antegrade. So retrograde, I'll ask you, what happened yesterday in the news? And you say, well, I don't watch TV, okay? And then I'll say, remember three things, cat, pillow, and chair. And I'll ask you the same things 5 minutes later, and you can't remember them. That's antegrade amnesia. And then what happens more and more nowadays is I forget to ask you, so you don't have to worry about it. You can also have peripheral neuropathy, where you have a lot of numbness or burning or tingling in your arms and legs. So finally, you see this guy one more time. He's got cirrhosis, he's throwing up blood, he's jaundiced, he's dying, and he tells you that everything's okay. His sister is going to give him a liver transplant, but you know that his sister died 5 years ago, so he's just making this up, and he dies shortly after. And one thing you notice is while you're talking to him, he starts going like this. And this is called asteriscus, and what it means is your blood is full of ammonia because your liver can no longer get rid of ammonia from protein. So essentially, it's like you have ammonia floating around in your blood. And you get cirrhosis, you get scar tissue, you get what we call varices, where the blood tries to get around the liver and backs up. I'm going to show you a picture. And you get encephalopathy because your blood is full of toxins. You can't make proteins, so you fill up with fluid. And I'll show you some pictures of these. And this is a healthy liver, and on the bottom is a cirrhotic liver, a scarred liver. And this can either be from alcoholism or from are also very commonly from hepatitis C. You also can get this, by the way, from Tylenol. So, now this is somebody who looks like they're about 38 weeks pregnant, right? But there's a beard up there, okay? And there's a telltale sign on the right which says Veterans Administration. And this is a gentleman who has end-stage cirrhosis with ascites, and you can also, it's difficult to see, but there's a spot up on his upper right where they just drained fluid off around his liver. And this is somebody who probably has a very, very short life expectancy. This is the blood trying to get around your liver. So it goes from your rectum all the way up to your chest, and it's called caput medusa. And this is blood that is supposed to be going straight through your liver and the rest of your body. And he has another yellow spot down there that's from betadine, and they just drained fluid off of him also. And this is the inside of an esophagus, which is supposed to be completely smooth. And look at those veins. That's the size of your thumb. Imagine nicking one of those veins while you're throwing up. People can lose like 10 to 20 units of blood in a matter of 5 minutes. All your blood just pours out and you die from bleeding from these. These are very difficult to control. And this gentleman in our example here died shortly after. In Narcotics Anonymous, they have a great phrase. It's called jails, institutions, and death, which is what faces the addict if they cannot stop using. Here's somebody who didn't stop using cocaine in time. You're looking up into the nasal area, and this is your septum that is being destroyed, and this is something that, because the blood flow is gone, is probably not fixable. We've already shown you this picture. Here's decreased blood flow in a cocaine addict, and we've shown you this picture as well. Here is a heroin addict who died from endocarditis, and what you're looking at is all over the surface of the inside of the heart is bacteria growing, and their heart ruptured. And this is because the bacteria started growing in the blood and it could not be stopped. This is somebody who got anthrax from injecting heroin. It happens very commonly out in California, I believe. I haven't seen any cases here. And here is somebody that is what we call shooting the pocket. When your veins are all gone, and addicts will use veins in their arms, legs, their genitals, and when that finally is gone, what you do is you hold your breath, push down, and the big veins in your neck pop out, and someone just plunges a needle in, and the problem is your lung is about 1 millimeter from there, and you can frequently drop a lung. Okay, so people always dismiss food as a problem. They say, well, you know, no one ever died, no one ever got arrested for, you know, eating, okay? But people die from eating disorders. People live in shame from eating disorders. And this is a description from step two of Overeaters Anonymous. It says, we have driven miles in the dead of night to satisfy a craving for food. We have eaten food that was frozen, burnt, stale, or even dangerously spoiled. We have eaten food off other people's plates, off the floor, off the ground. We have dug food out of the garbage and eaten it. That's addiction. I don't care if it's just food, that's addiction. And eating disorders is a whole separate talk, but basically the most common eating disorder there was, which is binge eating disorder, where you simply start eating and you can't stop, you feel terrible, you're not hungry, but you just have to eat, was just recognized a year ago, okay? That's how up to date with all this we are in addiction medicine. Okay, now, I'm going to turn this over for a reason. Everybody here is sitting like, Jesus Christ. And you're all be given the opportunity to give a summary at the end of the night. And this is one of the ones I got in 2007. And I said, well, I should start sharing more about treatment and more about the benefits of 12-step recovery. And this is what I got a couple of years later, saying I left tonight entirely without any So I realize, yeah, I'm good at giving you the bad news, but maybe not so good at giving you the good news. So tonight we're going to have something different. Dr. Brunner is going to talk about the treatment of addiction. And I just want to share one more slide. We've been talking about the disease of addiction. This is our dog. This is my wife, Kathy. She's a nurse practitioner that works out here in Ann Arbor. And this is our dog, Tommy. He's a Bouvier. And we've been talking about the disease of addiction. Tommy himself suffers from the disease of stupidity. We were going to raise him to be a therapy dog and take him down to Children's Hospital and, you know, visit the kids' wards and stuff. So we took him to therapy dog school. And about halfway through, the trainer sat down the anxious parents and said, you know, the lights are bright, but there is nobody home. So take Tommy home. So he's a great dog, but he's not a therapy dog. And here's my contact information. It's on the handout. And I'm going to stop here and turn it over to Emily. And we'll be able to answer questions after everyone's done.
Good evening. Thank you all for being here. And I also wanted to just take a moment to really reflect on Dr. Gibbons and how much this community lost when we lost him. He was irreplaceable. So we're going to go on to talk about the solution because it's not all bad news. There's a variety of different ways that people try to treat addiction. So there's, just like any other medical illness, like high blood pressure, you measure how high the blood pressure is and then sort of determine what to do. There's a variety of tools to use for addiction. It's not just sort of all you have is a hammer, so everything is a nail. So the first type of medication are agonists, which are basically like drug replacements, right? So just the idea of sort of tricking your brain by giving it a slightly less toxic substance, and then that will be appropriate. You'll be rewarded enough that you won't go seeking your drug of choice. That's sort of the idea behind that. There's Suboxone for opiate dependence, as well as methadone. Nicotine patches for tobacco dependence, marijuana for marijuana dependence, and Dilaudid for heroin dependence in Canada. So anyone who moves there will know why after this talk. And then the other sort of strategy often used is to be an antagonist, or to basically block those same receptors in the brain so that they cannot be activated by your drug of choice, so that theoretically you're unable to get high anymore. So there's a couple different forms of naltrexone to use for heroin or opiate dependence. There's Revia, which is oral. However, that has the unfortunate side effect that you only need one day to sort of plan to get high, because you just have to essentially not take the medication that one day. So it hasn't been quite very effective. And there's also injectable naltrexone or Vivitrol, which stays in your system for 1 month. And this sort of has the side effect where, unfortunately, if you're in a car accident or have any sort of emergency, it requires incredibly sort of high levels of opiate medication to get any sort of traction with pain control. Although it is possible to do, but you know, these aren't sort of perfect solutions, but appropriate tools for some. Naltrexone, the shot, is actually also used for alcohol dependence, and studies have shown that it reduces cravings for alcohol, and that's sort of unknown why exactly that is. Antabuse for alcohol dependence is not really used terribly often anymore because, unfortunately for this one, it essentially makes you feel quite ill when you drink and then use it. Sorry, if you take it and then drink. However, unfortunately, like, you can also die, so that is not a good solution either, usually. Ramonabant for obesity is just kind of another one of these blockers. There's also a medication called Campril, which is a novel mechanism and supposedly sort of calms down some of the excitatory neurotransmitters in the brain, and there is some evidence for that being effective also. In all these medications, none of them are like a perfect solution. Most of them have like a 40 to 60% success rate at around 1 to 2 years, and patients who stop them then relapse. So you have to kind of be on them for them to be effective, which is a little bit of a duh. Like, if you stop your blood pressure medication, your blood pressure goes up. Relapse, however, in this case, is often associated with increased chance of overdose and death. And then once again, I make the point about blood pressure because I thought that was a good one. So I see patients experiment with this all the time. Like, if I see the blood pressure is up when I enter the room, the number one question I ask is, did you take your medication today? And these pills, just like blood pressure medication, you know, they're not a permanent solution. It's not a cure to take a blood pressure medication. It's a strategy for changing your risk that day, essentially. And that's kind of a similar ideology. So, how long do you have to take these? And essentially, you know, that I think is still a lot more research to be done, but the most recent study, the most up-to-date things we have suggest that if you come off the medications, you relapse. So there was a study done on pregnant women with 101 women undergoing detox during their pregnancy. 40 of them were able to successfully detox, the others unable to do so. There were no adverse fetal effects, but only one of the patients documented to be abstinent was still abstinent at the time of delivery. So that's a pretty low success rate, right? That gets my attention. And then in other evidence of, maybe you think like, well, it's only pregnant women who need to be on Suboxone. Maybe other people can easily get off. So there's some studies of heroin addicts, with 20 being detoxed off and offered counseling, 20 being kept on and offered counseling, and then they were all followed up at a year, and 4 out of the 20 who had not been kept on Suboxone actually died. So that's a pretty, like, patient-oriented outcome, right? It's pretty much takes you out of the game if you die. It's not ideal. And you can see this is just like a very skewed graph. It's not a small effect. And then another study, this one is kind of determining whether the length of being on Suboxone and being detoxed makes any difference. So there were 654 patients put on buprenorphine for 2 weeks. And I'm using buprenorphine and Suboxone a little bit interchangeably. They're not exactly the same thing, but sort of for these purposes, I think it's okay. And after 3 to 4 weeks, they were tapered and then followed up again at about 12 weeks, and only 6.6% of them were still abstinent at that point. All the other ones had relapsed. So that's like a pretty dramatic result. So you may think maybe it's just, you know, the length of time they were detoxed too quickly. They took some of these same people, were willing to, I guess, go back and enroll in the study again, despite their horrible experience the first time, and 360 of them took buprenorphine then for 12 weeks, and then were tapered down, again followed up in 5 to 12 weeks, and at that point only 8.6% of those ones were able to stay abstinent. 49% were able to stay abstinent remaining on the buprenorphine. So this is showing, similar to the pill studies, that buprenorphine is effective about 50% of the time, with less than 10% of an ability to remain abstinent during the attempts to taper off. And also during this trial, standard medical management did not show any improvements based on rate of retained sobriety for also having opioid dependence counseling. In terms of methadone maintenance and the evidence behind that, there's pretty sort of clear, strong evidence from the 1980s showing that there's a clear reduction in IV drug use. This study is showing that it reduces from 100% in the people who are enrolled down about 70% during the period that they were on methadone. Then these people were taken off the methadone, and 80% of them went back to IV drug use. And this was also associated with changes in the outcomes of how many felonies were committed by these folks, how many of them passed away. There were other things besides just the relapsing. And then maybe if there's anyone in this audience who wants to like get her done fast and really make things quick, there's sometimes ads around for ultra-rapid detox. And this essentially doesn't end well. It's not, if you hear about this, please don't send your family members. It's not a good, there's no medical society that endorses this, essentially. Another really effective tool is cognitive behavioral therapy. And I apologize, I'm not a counselor, and so I'm sure I'm going to not describe this in the appropriate psychological way. But essentially, it boils down to, for me, the idea that behavior is due to false beliefs, and the belief is that you're unable to stop drinking. So if you change the underlying beliefs, then you're able to change the behavior. Again, apologies. And this is showing just that idea that kind of under the surface is all these submerged ideas and moods and behaviors and personality that's erupting up into action. And if you can interrupt the lower levels, you're able to change the behavior. In this case, the behavior obviously we're talking about is drinking or using drugs. So the mood would be a mood of pitiful, incomprehensible demoralization, which never feels too good. And the beliefs underlying that are often things like, there's no way I can stop using, so I might as well continue to use. There's definitely spiritual remedies for the treatment of alcoholism and drug addiction. One of the most common, which is freely available and present throughout many countries and certainly present throughout Ann Arbor, would be Alcoholics Anonymous, based on the 12-step program. There's also some rather angry people who don't agree with this spiritual solution alluded to by Dr. Christensen previously. I don't know. I personally wouldn't want to go to dinner with these guys. A common thing that people say about the idea of going to Alcoholics Anonymous, and I think something Dr. Christensen and I have both heard a time or two is, you know, I'm not religious, I don't believe in God, that's just a cult, and so I can't go. And there really is a strong distinction between spirituality and religion. One is organized and one is a more sort of way of living. I'm sure there's much better philosophers who can describe this, and I'm sure you can find them online. I'm going to leave it there. But a good example would be like the United States Marine Corps, which would be a commitment to something greater than yourself. You know, it's God, country, and corps. God, country, and corps. And then if alcohol is not your drug of choice, there are plenty of other 12-step programs. There's 12-step programs that are weirdly specific. and the internet has sort of only made them more easy to access. So all of them are based on the same sort of spiritual underpinnings that are in Alcoholics Anonymous. And what about this Alcoholics Anonymous? Has anyone ever done a study about that and shown objectively? Because that's, I know, one of the things that, you know, I went to MIT and I really want evidence for things that I do. Like, I want to look at the facts, and I wish I could calculate the statistics, but I like to know that someone has calculated the statistics, and then I'll read them. And this is a study, Project MASH, which shows so it's a little bit confusing, this slide, but it's essentially showing the people who are able to remain abstinent past 3 months when using 12-step programs, which is the black bar, motivational interviewing, which is the one in the middle, and then cognitive behavioral therapy, which is the lowest bar. So I especially apologize if you're a cognitive behavioral therapist. But there are plenty of really good uses for that. In this bar, you can see that at 3 years, the people who are enrolled in 12-step programs and got 12-step facilitation were significantly more likely to stay sober. This is another study on the efficacy of AA, showing alcohol abstinence and 12-step exposure in a group of veterans at 1 year and then again at 18 months. In both groups, you are significantly more likely to stay sober if attending AA meetings. And then, just to give you a brief crash course in pharmacology, one of the things that's often used to determine whether a drug is a drug is a dose response curve, showing that if you take a higher dose of the drug, you get a better effect. So, this is a dose response curve for AA meetings, showing that the more AA meetings you go to, the more likely you are to stay sober. With, as you can see, the group of people over on the right who was lucky enough to go to more than 50 meetings in a 90-day period, which really isn't that many. Often people are advised to do one a day for the first 3 months, and they were much more likely to stay continuously sober, and the more meetings people went to, the more likely they were to stay sober. There's surgical treatment of addiction. We were talking about the different categories. This is obviously one of the more controversial ones in China. I believe they stopped doing this because it didn't go well in the end, but they tried destroying the nucleus accumbens in China and Russia, and they found that the people did not do much heroin, but they didn't do a lot of other stuff either. So it wasn't an ideal result. And then, you know, there's obviously other surgeries for the end stages of cirrhosis. You can get a liver transplant. And again, Dr. Christensen had discussed the gastric bypass for eating disorders. Definitely an efficacious therapy for losing weight, but maybe not getting the underlying problem often. And then just to really discuss also that, again, detox is not the same as treatment. Just like for diabetes, you wouldn't give someone 1 week of insulin and then declare them cured and send them away. For hypertension, you wouldn't give someone treatment for 1 week and then after a week of normal blood pressure, you'll never have a stroke or heart attack. Like, it's a similar sort of thing here. Why bother to treat addiction? I believe that Dr. Christensen got this slide outside of his methadone clinic because of his very nice car. Actually, his car is not this nice, but someone had it. just also to throw out, like, this is a disease that does not just affect the addict. So the theory of, those folks are bad, just let them get what they deserve, like, doesn't really hold up, also considering the number of families affected. I mean, something like 45% of adults are directly exposed to the pain of substance abuse via close relatives. 50 to 80% of all child abuse and neglect cases involve some degree of substance abuse by the child's parents. So the idea of sort of letting people flounder around and fail and get back up on their feet if they can, it sort of breaks down when you look at the fact that these are people embedded in a family structure, really affecting a lot of other, not that I think that that's right anyway, but even if it was, they're still affecting people who are innocent. Why treat addiction? So there's a lot of talk in the medical profession about addicts maybe as not being the best use of your time and medical resources, because only about 40% of people will be abstinent at 1 year after treatment. However, this is a group of people with a lot of issues getting to aftercare, often due to insurance issues or homelessness. There's also some psychiatric comorbidities that either happen before or after the drinking or using, and a decaying of the social supports that really make it a challenge to treat any disease in this population. Relapse, it's however reinforced by the medical system, treating it as sort of inevitable and often hopeless. However, that's a really erroneous way to look at things. Like, for all chronic diseases, they require a continuous monitoring and treatment period. So there was a big study in 2000 showing the difference between recovery in terms of continuous abstinence for alcoholics and addicts versus the ability to perfectly control blood pressure or hypertension or asthma. And as you can see, that 40 to 60% of people with a diagnosis of drug dependence were able to remain abstinent. Less than 40% of hypertensives adhere to their treatment regimen. Less than 40% of asthmatics adhere to their regimen. And only 60% of type 1 diabetics adhere to their medication schedule. So this is not a group of irresponsible people who aren't doing a good job. This is just the way that we all manage chronic diseases. It's difficult and it's a daily process. So just to really drive it home, you know, if you stop taking your insulin and go to the ICU, your doctor will say, go back on insulin, you could have died. If you were to stop your Suboxone, Methadone, or 12-step program and wind up in the ICU, your doctor would say, you're an addict, you're hopeless, and then try to find you a new doctor. This is just going back to the study showed before, just showing that with opioid maintenance therapy, there's decreased HIV infection, incarceration, drug use, and mortality. So those are some pretty important benefits, obviously. I don't understand. Hang on a second. So this slide is about needing to continue treatment. I think we've been really hammering that point home. Other chronic treatable diseases include obesity, hypertension, diabetes, asthma, and addiction. So I think there is an underlying theme here, which is that addiction is a disease. Refusing to treat an alcoholic who relapses is like refusing to do a cardiac bypass for someone who continues to eat hamburgers. And I have treated many of those patients, and they often eat hamburgers. And if you remember just one thing, because I think there are studies that from a long, boring PowerPoint presentation, you remember approximately 2 to 3 facts. So I wanted to get in on what those facts should be. I think number one, addiction is a disease. Like, it really just is. It just is. It's a disease. And then number two, addicts are sick people. They're not bad people. And they really deserve our help. And then, I also just want to thank you all for your attention and thank Dr. Christensen.
Any questions or comments? Sir.
Yes. In working with people, one thing, in terms of the basic theory of addiction, how do you explain to the individual who is pretty firmly diagnosed as having an addiction to, let's say, alcohol, and they experience pleasure response to other substances or behaviors, but do not develop the addiction process to those other substances or behaviors, which the theory almost says they're going to.
I've had that conversation, and what I tell them is, you know, you probably drank safely for a long time, and you may or may not get in trouble with this behavior, but there's a good expectation that it could happen. And typically, you know, you're talking to an alcoholic who is gambling or getting involved in some kind of behavior that's gonna turn into a problem. And I tell them it didn't happen quickly with alcohol, and it may not happen quickly with this, but it's likely to. So. Ma'am?
If dopamine seems to be the problem, and is that true also for gamblers who have an addiction?
Probably what they call processed behaviors, yeah, you can do brain scans on almost any behavioral addiction and you see the same thing.
Well, there's food that triggers dopamine in the brain. Would that be helpful? Has that ever been tried?
As a treatment? The problem with doing that is that for every dopamine increase you do, you have a dopamine decrease. And if you have addiction, that is, you kind of wind up in the gerbil cage. So you wind up going up and down, up and down.
Okay.
So all the drugs we've tried using that increase dopamine, and there's a whole long list, have not worked for addiction.
If you stay away from the substance long enough, does the brain ever heal, and how long does it take?
So typically, there's good news and bad news. The good news is that at 2 years, you'll get back what you are going to have, but you may not ever get back to what you started with. You may have brain damage from the drug use. And remember, you were probably born that way as well. So you will recover, you get your maximum recovery at about 2 years, but it may never be, you're never going to be somebody who can safely use.
You mentioned the 4 or 5 C's. If you're a certain or an addict, are you looking at someone who would fill all 4 or 5, or can they fill 2 of the 5 C's? Which is someone diagnosed with?
It's definitely not all about just diagnosing C's. Generally, they're used to sort of screen. And someone who has 2 or more of the C's is usually someone who maybe should talk to their physician or a trained professional.
You were talking about how these drugs have effects, how they kill dopamine in your brain. When is the fluoride in our water, the GMOs in our food, when does that kill it just as the same?
I'm not aware of anything that any evidence for that? No.
Given that you're saying the number of people who abuse versus people who are addicted, you know, there are a decent amount, you know, not that many in percentage-wise people who abuse are actually addicted. Do you suggest a particular way to deal with someone who's an abuser? Because, I mean, there's all these, get your DUI, you have to go to this thing, you go to the drug court. So if you're an abuser of it, do you just treat everyone like they're addicted, or what have you seen as the most beneficial?
So in general, if you're identified with a problem like that, and so like let's say someone has a DUI and they are an abuser and it was an unfortunate circumstance and just the one time they ever drove drunk and they got picked up on a DUI, then that person will usually just stop drinking. Like that's kind of the normal response. So then that really, the definition really comes in what comes next. Like what sort of behaviors do they continue to engage in? It's not easy to make a specific diagnosis immediately. It usually requires a little bit of time.
So they'll cancel themselves out, you're saying, out of the...
Yes, they cancel out of the abuser category by continuing to drink, usually.
If you remove the substance and the brain heals to the greatest extent possible, but they've got less dopamine, does that mean they're happy or unhappy? I mean, is there hope for happiness in the future without the drug?
Yes, there's hope for happiness.
You showed a slide that had three modalities of treatment for substance meetings, motivational interviewing, and cognitive behavioral therapy. What's the information with the evidence that shows the preferred, the most successful method of treatment? And secondly, what's your preferred method of treatment?
Well, on that slide, it was showing that out of those three different things, 12-step facilitation was the most effective. And generally, I mean, I think that there's no 100% right answer for every person. I think it really is dependent.
Yes, you did not mention, and I'm not sure the exact effect on the dopamine, but the use of antidepressant medications for people, you know, not necessarily immediately, but as a part of a long-term intervention to help them with kind of getting more towards a baseline of happiness, or at least a more of a baseline of pre-existing depressive.
So I think if there's underlying untreated depression that begins before the addiction, then there's a role sometimes in antidepressants and of addressing that appropriately.
I think
there's no evidence that I'm aware of for treating addiction specifically with antidepressants.
But I think there's a pretty high incident of pre-existing depression.
Yeah, and I think we're saying the same thing. If you have pre-existing depression, that's different from treating addiction with antidepressants.
Right, but go on. But
so if you take the drugs away and the problem goes away, then you don't need antidepressants. If it comes back or has been there for a long period of time before use.
But if part of the theory is that it starts out as a dopamine deficiency, it sort of implies that there's a...
Depression, this is sort of outside the topic, but usually is thought to be related to serotonin and norepinephrine. Dopamine is more related to psychosis. So,
is there any connection between addiction and obsessive-compulsive disorder?
There's like an increased incidence of that combination of people with obsessive compulsive disorder having a higher incidence of addiction.
Having just found out about 12-step facilitation as an overall treatment rather than just 12-step meetings, you know, because of the purposeful disconnect between going to AA and being involved in 12-step treatment. How widespread is 12-step facilitation and treatment? I mean, because I know we're in a little bubble here, but in general, is 12-step facilitation as done for Project Match? You know, with the whole huge book of things you do.
The main thing that they were doing in that was getting people ensconced in AA. So that was sort of their main intervention. It wasn't a lot. I mean, they did do specific counseling.
Yeah, because I found there's like a whole 60-page, you know, session by session therapy that goes along with it. Is that being used in high, you know, a lot?
There are places that use that.
Emily? A question for Dr. Christensen. I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. What did you say was the most common after bariatric surgery problem that you get, the most common question you get from people?
Oh, after they've had bariatric surgery, or the most common problem afterwards?
After bariatric surgery, I understood you to say there was one.
Oh no, the second most common reason I get asked to see somebody in the hospital is because they've had bariatric surgery.
Because what?
They've had bariatric surgery and now they have another addiction.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And that seems to be a common after.
Well, if you look at the number of people having bariatric surgery, it's much larger. But the bariatric surgery ward is about half full of people who have this complication. It's pretty dramatic. I know Brighton Hospital specializes in this for one thing.
Thank you.
So I'm not familiar with the brain scan research, but it's known that all the things that were going wrong when you were using heroin, for example, would normalize when you start on methadone. So people, their hormones normalize, they get pregnant, they have regular cycles, their health returns. So if you're looking at the outcome, which is your health and everything else, yes. So,
are there any reasons why antabuse would not work for some people the way it's supposed to?
Well, antabuse works in one situation, which is called network therapy, which means that your spouse puts a gun to your head and says, swallow this or leave. And that's the point. So we call it network therapy. But there's all kinds of ways around this. I know of a doctor who painted all his antabuse pills with nail polish. So he would take them every morning, but they would go through his GI tract entirely indigested, and he was drinking every day, too. But network therapy claims to be
effective. What if they're actually taken and they're actually consumed and they don't work the way they're supposed to work?
I don't know of anybody who drank on antabuse who didn't have a horrible experience. I know people who drank through antabuse because they were alcoholics, but I don't know anybody who didn't say it was like going through hell. We'll stay down here for any other questions. Otherwise, thank you for coming.